By now, you probably can begin to see where sacred geometry falls into this. Where do these shapes originate? Do they just come into being at random? Or does the first shape come from somewhere else? In Lesson 6, we talked about the Flower of Life, the original, perfect geometric symmetry that created the universe. This shape, as we learned, is not only the root of all mathematical proportion, light, the Platonic solids, but is also the source of every musical system in the universe, including systems both used and unknown to modern man. It is also the source of energy patterns and, well, everything. It all comes from the Flower of Life. I believe this is what is at the heart of what's forming every subatomic particle formation, and it probably goes at least a few levels deeper than what Garrett is showing us. Now we can start talking about dimensions. These wheels are some of the oldest symbols known. The only places that they've been found is on the ceilings of certain very old Egyptian tombs. They are always found in sets of 4 or 8, and nobody knows what they are. Even the most famous Egyptologists have no idea, but this is actually proof that the Egyptians not only understood the Flower of Life, but they lived it. Today, I'm going to show you what these wheels meant, and in future lessons, we will go over the details of this unraveling. There's a lot to cover before we get there, though. For the record, the unraveling looks like this. Yeah, it's a doozy. So on the walls with these wheels are drawings of 7 people with animal heads. They're called kneaders, and each of them has an orangish-red oval above its head. This is called the egg of metamorphosis. The kneaders are showing us a time when we go through a certain stage of resurrection, which is a rapid biological change into a different life form. Not the average type of resurrection, I know. As you can see here, they're changing directions 90 degrees, and in doing so, they're changing dimensions. See, the dimensional levels are separated by 90 degrees. Musical notes are separated by 90 degrees. The chakras are also 90 degrees. It's a number that continually appears. Probably at this point, we should get a common understanding of what dimensions are, like 3rd dimension, 4th dimension, 5th dimension. What are we talking about here? Most people think of dimension in terms of time and space, the X, Y, and Z axis, with time becoming the 4th dimension. This is not what we are talking about. What we're seeing as the various dimensional levels has more to do with music and harmonics than anything else. A piano has 8 white keys from C to C, which is the familiar octave, and in between there are 5 black keys. Together, this creates what is called the chromatic scale, which is 13 notes, well, actually 12, with the 13th being the first in the next octave. So from one C to the next is really 13 steps, not 8. This also correlates with the 7, 8, and 13 chakra system I mentioned in Lesson 2. Keeping that in mind, I want to show you a sine wave. Sine waves correspond with light and the electromagnetic spectrum and the vibration of sound. We're all very familiar with this. In this entire reality we're in, every single thing is based on sine waves. There are no exceptions to this except for maybe spirit and void. Quantum physics and quantum mechanics looks at everything in the reality of one of two ways. You can look at anything, like the computer you're watching this video on, to be made up of tiny particles like atoms. Or you can forget about that idea completely and look at it as a vibration, a waveform, such as electromagnetic fields or even sound. If you look at it as atoms, the laws can be seen to fit that model. But if you look at it as waveforms, the laws can be seen to fit that model. Both of these systems come out of the Flower of Life, one being the one we just looked at, Fruit of Life to Metatron's Cube and beyond, and the other being this beautiful mess of a picture. Just looking at it hurts my head. Everything in this world is a waveform, or can be seen as sound. All things, your bodies, planets, absolutely everything, are a waveform. If you choose this particular way of looking at reality, and then superimpose that view over the reality of the harmonics of music, we can begin to talk about dimensions. The dimensional levels are nothing but different base rate wavelengths. The only difference between this dimension and any other is the length of its basic waveform. It's just like a radio set. Turn the dial, you pick up a wavelength. It's the same with dimensions. If you were to change the wavelength of your consciousness, and in doing so change all of your body patterns to a wavelength different from this universe, you would literally disappear out of this world and reappear in the one you were tuned in. It's been theorized that the base rate wavelength that we're currently living in is 7.23 centimeters. There's a few reasons for this. In a spiritual sense, the 7.23 wavelength is Om, the Hindu sound of the universe. Maybe that's why Oming is such a powerful tool in meditation. Not only that, but if you were to take 100 people and measure the distance between their eyes, the average length is 7.23. Same with the distance from the tip of our chins to the tip of our noses, and the distance across our palms and between our chakras. This 7.23 length is located throughout our bodies in various ways because we are emerged within this particular dimension. There's another reason as well. Bell Laboratories found this wavelength when they were setting up the microwave system around the United States. They found static in their system because they chose a wavelength just slightly longer than 7.23 for their system. In order to get rid of the static, they did something that we as a planet are still suffering from. They upped the power 50,000 times over what we would normally need, which created a very powerful field, so that the 7.23 wavelength would not interfere. It's for those reasons that I believe 7.23 is the wavelength of our dimension. As you go up in dimensional levels, the wavelength gets shorter and shorter, with higher and higher energy. As you go down in levels, the wavelength gets longer and longer, with lower and lower energy, more and more dense. Just as with a piano, there's a space between the notes, so that when you hit one note, there's a very definite place where the next note is. In this waveform universe we exist in, there's a very definite place where the next dimensional level exists. It's specific wavelength relative to this one. Most cultures in the cosmos have a basic understanding of this and understand how to change between dimensions. However, because of certain events that happened on Earth 13,000 years ago, we have all forgotten, but we're about to remember. So if we show each note in the chromatic scale as a circle, we have 13 circles. Each circle represents a white or black key, and the shaded circle at the end would be the 13th note that begins the next octave. This circle here represents the third dimension. This is where we are, and this circle next to it would be the fourth. In lesson 3, we talked about channeling, and this is typically where channeled beings are. This is also where you explore when you are astral projecting or lucid dreaming. You'll notice now that the musical system goes upwards and downwards forever, octaves over octaves over octaves. Theoretically, this is how the universe goes too, an infinite spectrum of universes in both directions going upwards and downwards forever. I mean, come on, we thought our universe was big, but everything in our universe, as far as we can see, well, that's just this one dimension. You may have heard people talk about 144 dimensions and how 144 relates to other spiritual subjects. This is because there are 12 notes in an octave and 12 overtones between each note. 12 times 12 equals 144 dimensional levels. To be specific, there are 12 major dimensions and 132 minor dimensions within each octave, though in truth this progression probably goes on forever. The diagram we've been looking at represents one octave, the 13 note repeats, and then there's another octave after that. Looks like I'm about done for the day. I want to show you this. I was watching Ancient Aliens not long ago, and one of the natives who has communication with beings in higher dimensions told the man who was interviewing him
that they have always been here, even right here where we're sitting right now, but you just don't see them. They're in a different frequency.
And no one really got what he meant. So that's kind of a fresh perspective on that.
It is referred to as the architecture of the universe, and even the fingerprint of God. Sacred geometry is found throughout the natural world. Indeed, it is all around us, an aspect of the true matrix, if you have the eye to see it. It is also one of the very few subjects which appeals to both left brain and right brain ways of thinking at the same time. It satisfies the left brain's desire for logical, sequential, and objective data, or to put it simply, looking at the parts. It also satisfies the right brain's desire for random, intuitive, and subjective data, the study of the whole. It is simply not possible to cover all aspects of sacred geometry. People have spent entire lifetimes contemplating just one aspect of sacred geometry, such as a rabbi studying the Kabbalistic Tree of Life. I will do my best to introduce you to the basics and hopefully inspire you to research further on your own. The only logical place to start is to show you how nature created its very first pattern. Nature can also be substituted with God or spirit, whatever is your preferred term, it doesn't matter, as they are describing the same one reality that we all share. It is also interesting to note that Genesis in the Bible essentially describes the process I'm about to show you. However, it should be told that this wisdom was most likely taken from the ancient Egyptian mystery schools and that it is not original to the Bible. In the beginning, there was the void, and within this infinite void is the Spirit of God. This Spirit has not manifested anything yet, so the Eye of Horus I'm using here to represent the Spirit of God is not a reality. In other words, essentially God and the void are one, but obviously I cannot show you God and the void as one, as they cannot be depicted graphically at the same time. That is the nature of emptiness. At this point, there are no dimensions, or space, and there is no time. There is also only two options available for God. Remain in this state of static omnipresence or begin creating. God will begin creation eventually, however, as there is no time, it is irrelevant to ask how long it took to make the decision to begin creating reality. Okay, so now God has decided to begin creation. But before this can happen, God needs to create a canvas on which he is to paint his masterpiece. The first thing that God does is create the three dimensions. It does this by projecting a beam of consciousness from a single point in all six directions, front, back, left, right, up, and down, in equal measure. Bear in mind that the void is infinite and that distance has not been defined yet, so it does not matter how far these beams are projected from the point, it makes no difference. You must also understand that what I'm showing here graphically is not a reality. That is, the structures being created are not material in any form. They are imaginary lines. They are pure consciousness. You may need to pause or replay this video several times before the implications become apparent to you. At this point, God is halfway to creating space. In order to complete this process, it must define some boundaries, because as I mentioned before, the void is infinite, and if no boundaries are defined, then relative movements of spirits remain impossible. To define some boundaries, all God needs to do is connect the end of every point to the end of every other point. The beauty of this, and indeed the entire process itself, is that God cannot make a mistake. It is simply impossible. Once all the ends are connected, what we have is an octahedron, which if viewed from the correct perspective reveals a hexagram, also known as the Star of David. Now that some boundaries have been defined, relative movements are now possible. The single point of consciousness can now move away from the defined central location, whereas previously there was nothing to move relative to. In the Bible, Eve was supposedly created from Adam's rib. Obviously this has no relevance to the present world, except maybe with unnatural fetus creation techniques. But when this story is compared with the next step in the process, you can begin to appreciate the idea that maybe the Bible is only an exoteric recreation of an older esoteric wisdom. The octahedron is made up of purely straight lines. In sacred geometry, straight lines are considered to be male, and curved lines female. So at this point, what we have is a purely male shape. This is why the Freemasons consider the male to be the generating principle. The next step involves spinning this octahedron in one full rotation around each of the three axes defined previously. Again, no mistake can be made. It does not matter which direction it is spun, or in what order the axes are chosen. The end result will always be that the parameters of a perfect sphere have been traced. Now we have a purely female shape. Eve has now been created from Adam. God has now created a perfect spherical membrane, and once again, it only has two options available. It can either remain static and explore this imaginary shape for all eternity, or it can repeat the process described thus far. The only difference is now God has a reference point, the spherical membrane, on which to repeat the process. It does not matter where spirit chooses on the membrane to begin the process, as it is a perfect sphere, thus all points are identical to each other. It cannot make a mistake. At this point, God only knows how to do two things: projecting an octahedron and creating a spherical membrane, and moving its point of awareness to what is newly created. The next step is described in Genesis in the Bible, and thus the next process is commonly referred to as the Genesis pattern. So God moves to the surface of the newly created spherical membrane and begins projecting another identical sphere. God moved upon the face of the waters, and God said, "Let there be light." This has created a very special shape called the vesica piscis. This shape can be found twice in your own body: the appearance of the human eye behind the eyelids, and also the lens within the eye, which adjusts the focus of light. The significance of this connection demonstrates both a left brain and a right brain idea, and it certainly shocked me when I was first introduced to it. Once again, God only has two options: remain static or project another sphere. To project the third sphere, God moves to what is newly created, which is this circle equator created by the two original intersecting spheres. Again, it does not matter where God chooses on this circle as the central point for the third sphere, as all points on this circle are identical. After the third sphere is created, there is only one more rule God follows when creating the rest of the spheres which complete the first stage of this pattern. The rule is, always move to the innermost circle points before projecting another sphere. This results in the process being perfect and prevents a chaotic mess being created. At the creation of each new sphere, more and more patterns, or information, become available, such as the vesica piscis mentioned earlier. The patterns contained within after each new sphere is added is far too extensive to cover in detail. All that remains to be said is after seven spheres have been created in a vortex-like motion, what we have as a result is known as the seed of life. This basic pattern lays the foundation for the creation of matter and the universe itself. It also gives rise to a shape known as a tube torus if the pattern is spun around the central point. This shape is the only one in existence that can fold upon itself. It is also composed of seven equal segments which can be displayed visually using the seven colors of the visible light spectrum.